first off say that, as I said, I do read all of the comments, and I have been, or I did get a concerning comment about, they said that it was distracting me holding up my Apple mic, but let me just say that I don't really have much of an option because I am new to the ASMR community, and I do not have the equipment to where I can, like, not hold up my Apple mic. I don't have any fancy microphones yet, so if you guys do find that distracting, I apologize, and if you're, you know, interested, and maybe, you know, I could start a Patreon and do some kind of special videos, and if you're interested, you know, you could maybe donate, and I could put that money towards buying better equipment and microphones and everything, but, you know, that may be something for me to kind of think about. However, you know, like I said, I apologize if the mic is distracting for you guys, and hopefully I can get that fixed very soon. So before I get into the case, I did just want to ask you guys a question. On this channel, I try to focus more on lesser known cases, but I know that some people, they want to hear, like, the larger cases. So my question to you guys is, would you be more interested in hearing, like, smaller cases that not a lot of people have covered, or would you be interested in hearing more popular and, like, famous cases? Like, for example, I could do a video on, like, JonBenet Ramsey or something like that. So just let me know in the comments down below. And also, if you have not subscribed, if you could hit that subscribe button before I start the case, that would be awesome. You can turn on the little bell and get all the notifications for when my videos are going live. And if you have not subscribed, you should do so. But if you have not subscribed, let me know in the comments below why you have not subscribed. Is there a reason? Is there something you do or don't like about the channel that you would like to see me improve on to where you will want to subscribe? So just go ahead and let me know in the comments below. And also, before I begin this case, this is going to be a rather gruesome case, so just, I'm giving you a heads up. If you are a little bit squeamish, then just exit out of this video, because this is probably actually going to be the most gruesome case I've covered so far. And I also have a couple notes off to the side, just so, if I'm trying to make sure I get all of the names and dates correct. So if I'm looking off to the side, that is what I'm looking at. So otherwise, I'm going to go ahead and jump into the case, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Alright, so today we are going to be talking about the case of the cannibal killer, Katherine Mary Knight. So Katherine Mary Knight was born in 1955 in Australia. She was born in a very unconventional and dysfunctional family. She grew up in the small town of Aberdeen in New South Wales, Hunter Valley in Australia, to a woman named Barbara Rohan. So Barbara had four sons with her husband, Jack Rohan, but shortly after, Barbara began having an affair with a man named Ken Knight, and Ken Knight was a friend and co-worker of hers, or of her husband's, rather, and in the community in Aberdeen, both of the families were very well known and very well liked where they lived, and the affair did become major news in Aberdeen, and, you know, it was very well known that there was an affair going on, and people were just kind of, like, chit-chatting and gossiping about it everywhere, so it was a major scandal in Aberdeen at the time. Plus, this was in the 50s, and it was not very common for, you know, affairs to happen and divorce and all this stuff, so people were very, you know, chatty about it. So because of this, they were kind of shunned in the town, and they were forced to leave Aberdeen, and So Ken Knight was an alcoholic, and he openly used violence and intimidation against her mother. And it was written that her mother had been raped about 10 times a day by Ken Knight. Her mother was very graphic in what she talked about regarding her sexual life to her children. She often told her daughters intimate details about her sex life with Ken Knight, and also said how much she hated sex and how much she hated men. So later, when Katherine complained to her mother when she was a teenager, she was dating a boy that she knew, and she complained to her mother that her boyfriend wanted her to take part in a sex act that she did not want to perform and that she was not comfortable with. And her mother, Barbara, told her to, quote, put up with it and stop complaining. So, Katherine claims also that she was frequently sexually assaulted as a child by several members of her family, although she said that her father had never sexually assaulted her. It was other members of her family, and this occurred until she was 11 years old. So, as Katherine got older, when she entered school at Miss Wellbrook High School in Australia, she became a loner and was said to have been a bully by her classmates. She apparently assaulted at least one boy at school with a weapon and was once injured by a teacher. And the teacher had said that they had tried to act in self-defense and had injured Katherine in the process. So apparently when she was not raging and when she was not mad and hitting people and being a bully, her classmates and teachers said that she was a model student somehow and earned rewards for good behavior, which is a very odd dichotomy, but we'll just move along. So when Katherine was 15 years old, she actually decided to drop out of school. And at 15, she had not, this is the part I don't understand, at 15 years old, although she had been in school, she apparently did not know how to read or write. I don't know how that's possible. That's just from my experience. So she dropped out of school and got a job as a cutter at a clothing factory. So as she was working in the clothing factory, she worked at that job for about 12 months, and she later decided to leave that job. She wasn't really liking it, and decided to pursue her dream job, which was cutting up offal. I'm not sure what that is. At the local abattoir, and abattoir is basically like a butcher shop, from what I can tell. Where she was quickly promoted to boning and given her own set of butcher knives, which was a dream for Katherine to have her own set of butcher knives. So at home, she hung the knives over her bed so that they would, quote, always be handy if I needed them. Very odd. A habit she continued until her incarceration everywhere she lived. So every time she moved house, she would just hang those butcher knives right up above the bed, like she always did. Bad Katherine. Alright. So, fast forward a little bit to 1973, and Katherine met her first husband, David Stanford Kellett, and she ended up marrying him in 1974. So, on her wedding day, Katherine's mother, Barbara, gave David some advice and said, quote, "The old girl said to me to watch out. She said, you better watch this one or she'll fucking kill you. Stir her up the wrong way or do the wrong thing and you're fucked. Don't ever think of playing up on her. She'll fucking kill you." And that was her mother talking. She told me she's got something loose. She's got a screw loose somewhere. So, that's Barbara for you. So, if that wasn't already concerning, on their wedding night, Katherine tried to strangle David because he fell asleep after only having intercourse 3 times, and she was not okay with that. So, the marriage was noted to have been quite violent, and at one point, Katherine burned all of David's clothing and hit him in the back of the head with a frying pan, which would continue to be to leave Catherine for another woman and move to Queensland because he could not cope with her possessive, violent behavior. So after he left her the next day, Catherine was seen pushing her new baby in a stroller down Main Street in Australia, violently throwing the stroller from side to side. And people stopped her and were panicking. We're like, what are you doing with this poor child? And because of this, she was admitted to St. Elmo's Hospital in Tamworth, Australia, where she was diagnosed with postnatal depression and spent several weeks recovering in the hospital. After being released, Knight placed her two-month-old Melissa on a train railway shortly before the train was scheduled to cross, and then stole an axe, went to town, and threatened to kill several people. So it's not, Melissa did not die. I could not find information as to if she had taken Melissa off the tracks or if someone had found Melissa and taken her off the tracks, but she was safe. The train did not hit her. To say that now. So, shortly after this, Catherine had another incident of violence where she slashed the face of a woman with one of her knives that she had over her bed and took a young boy hostage. She asked the woman who she slashed the face of, she tried to get her to drive to the town where her ex-husband was living, and she ended up not being able to get there because she was stopped by the police and admitted to the Morissette Psychiatric Hospital. So, she was released from the hospital in 1976 and moved to Woodridge, Australia, a suburb of Brisbane, where she worked at a meatpacking plant. So, fast forward 4 years to 1980, when she would give birth to her second daughter, Natasha Marie. In 1986, her relationship with her ex-husband had completely fallen to shambles, and she was kind of on the prowl for a new man, and she met a 38-year-old minor, named David Saunders, and a few months after they had met, he moved in with her and her two daughters. In 1987, she cut the throat of his two-month-old dingo pup in front of him. For no other reason than to show him what would happen if she were to ever, or if he were to ever leave her. So, she also, for the second time, to another man, knocked him unconscious with a frying pan. Yeah. So, in June 1988, she gave birth to her third daughter, Sarah, and the two officially put a deposit on a new house. They were very excited. They were kind of starting a new life together. They had a baby together, and they were ready to settle down and just start fresh. So apparently, Catherine decorated the new house with animal skins, skulls, horns, rusty animal traps, leather jackets, old boots, machetes, rakes, and pitchforks. There was no space, including the ceilings, that was left uncovered. So from floor to ceiling was covered in animal skin, skulls, horns, and other knickknacks of Catherine's. Switch hands with the mic. Ooh, excuse me. After an argument, she, as they were living together, they had another argument, which is again very common for Catherine. And she hit her husband in the, or hit her boyfriend in the face before, with an iron, before stabbing him in the stomach with a pair of scissors. So he freaked the fuck out and moved to Scone, Australia. But when he returned home, he had found she had cut up all his clothes. Knight tried to find him, or Catherine tried to find him, but no one admitted to knowing his whereabouts. So she was pissed, and several months later, he returned to see his daughter and found that Catherine had gone to the police and unjustly told him she was afraid of him. They issued her an apprehended violence order, or an ABO, against him. So, in 1991, she gave birth to another child, this time her first son, and his name was Eric. So Eric was born to her and her baby daddy, which was a coworker named John Chillingsworth. The relationship lasted approximately 3 years before she left him for a man she'd been having an affair with. He was a minor named John Price. So, a little bit about John Price. John Charles Thomas Price was the father of three children before he met Katherine and was very well liked in the community. He knew Katherine was violent. He knew of her violent tendencies, but thought that he could look past that because something about Katherine attracted him to her. I'm not quite sure what it was. Despite this, they moved in together in 1995, and when she moved in, his children really liked her, and life seemed to be going great despite a few violent arguments, but it was nothing really too concerning. So in 1998, after having lived together for 3 years, they had a fight over John's refusal to marry her, and I'm not quite sure why specifically, but was fired from the job he had held for 17 years, and he really had no choice, and his boss really just had to fire him. The same day, he kicked Katherine out, and she returned to her home. While news of what she had done spread throughout the town, so she was pretty embarrassed by this. So a few months later, John restarted the relationship with Katherine, although he now refused to allow her to move in with him. The fighting became even more frequent, and most of his friends would no longer have anything to do with him while they remained together because they were afraid of Katherine as well. In February of 2000, John kicked Katherine out of the house after a series of assaults against him in the altercation, which she stabbed him in the chest. On February 29th, 2000, he took out a restraining order in an attempt to keep her from him and his children. Alright, so this is something I'm going to have to read verbatim because it has a lot of very specific information. I'm just going to look off to the side and read this part straight as I've written it. So that afternoon, Price told his co-workers that if he did not come to work the next day, it would be because Knight had killed him. They pleaded with him not to go home, but he told them that he believed she would kill his children if he did not. John arrived home to find that Katherine, although not there herself, had sent the children away for a sleepover at a friend's house. He then spent the evening with his neighbors before returning home and going to bed at 11 p.m. Earlier that day, Knight had bought new black lingerie and had videotaped all her children while making comments, which have since been interpreted as a crude will. Knight later arrived at John's house while he was sleeping and sat watching TV for a few minutes before having a shower. She then woke John and they had sex, after which he fell asleep. At 6 a.m. the next day, the neighbor became concerned that John's car was still in the driveway. When Price did not arrive at work, his employer sent a worker to see what was wrong. Both the neighbor and worker tried knocking on Price's bedroom window to wake him, but alerted police after noticing blood on the front door. Police arrived at 8 a.m. Breaking down the back door, police found Price's body with Katherine comatose from taking a large number of pills. She had stabbed John with a butcher's knife while he was sleeping. According to the blood evidence, he awoke and tried to turn the light on before attempting to escape while Katherine chased him through the house. He managed to open the front door and get outside, but either stumbled back inside or was dragged back out into the hallway, where he finally died after bleeding out. Later, Katherine went into Aberdeen and withdrew $1,000 from John's ATM account. John's autopsy revealed that he had been stabbed at least 37 times in both the front and back of his body, with many of the wounds extending into vital organs. Several hours after John had died, Katherine skinned him and hung the skin from the meat hook on the architrave of a door to the lounge room. She then decapitated him and cooked parts of his body, serving up the meat with baked potato, pumpkin, beetroot, zucchini, cabbage, yellow squash, and gravy, and two settings at the dinner table, along with notes beside each plate, each having the name of one of John's children on it. preparing to serve his body parts to his children. A third meal was thrown on the back lawn for unknown reasons, and it is speculated Katherine had attempted to eat it, but could not, and this has been put forward in support of her claim that she had no memory of the crime. John's head was found in a pot with vegetables. The pot was still warm, estimated to be at least 40 and 50 degrees Celsius, or 104 to 122 degrees Fahrenheit if you live in the U.S., and indicated the cooking had taken place early in the morning. Later on, Katherine arranged the drink bottle, arranged the body with the left arm draped over an empty 1.25 liter soft drink bottle with the legs crossed. This was claimed in court to be an act of defilement, demonstrating Katherine's contempt for John. Knight had left a handwritten note on top of a photograph of John, bloodstained and covered with small pieces of flesh. The note read, quote, "Time got you back, Jonathan, for raping my daughter. You too, Beck, for Ross, for little John. Now play with little John's dick, John Price." So, not quite sure what that means, but kind of creepy nonetheless. So, that was very creepy. So she killed John and skinned and cooked parts of his body. So in October 2001, her trial would begin. Katherine pleaded guilty, and the judge, because of this, the judge ordered a psychiatric evaluation of Katherine just to make sure that she knew what pleading guilty meant and if she was capable to plead guilty on her own accord. So Knight's legal team, I plan to defend Katherine by claiming amnesia and disassociation, a claim supported by most psychiatrists, although they did consider Katherine sane. Two psychiatrists concluded that Knight suffered from borderline personality disorder. So, no reason has ever been given for the guilty plea, and despite giving it, Katherine still refused to accept responsibility for her actions. At the sentencing hearing, Katherine's lawyers requested that Katherine be excused to avoid hearing some of the facts, but the application was refused. When Timothy Lyons took the stand and described the skinning and decapitation, Katherine became hysterical and had to be sedated. On the 8th of November, 2001, Justice O'Keefe pointed out that the nature of the crime and Knight's lack of remorse required a severe penalty. He sentenced her to life in prison, refusing to fix a non-parole period, and ordered that her papers be marked never to be released, the first time this has been imposed on a woman in Australian history. In June 2006, Knight appealed the life sentence, claiming that a penalty of life in prison without possibility of parole was too severe for the killing. Justices Peter McClellan, Michael Adams, and Megan Latham dismissed the appeal in the New South Wales Court of Criminal Appeal in September, with Justice McClellan writing in this judgment, "This was an appalling crime, almost beyond contemplation in a civilized society." Alright, so that is all the info that I have on that case. I hope you enjoyed it. If you liked this video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and make sure you drop me a comment down below and hit that subscribe button so you'll be notified every time I post a new video. I try to post ASMR trick